Good morning. Our call to worship this morning comes from Reverend Joan Javier Duval, who some of you may know from her time here at All Souls. You are beloved and you are welcome here. Whether tears have fallen from your eyes this past week or gleeful laughter has spilled out of your smiling mouth,
you are beloved and you are welcome here. Whether you are feeling brave or brokenhearted, defiant or defeated, fearsome or fearful,
you are beloved and you are welcome here. Whether you have untold stories buried deep inside or stories that have been forced beyond the edges of comfort,
you are beloved and you are welcome here. Whether you have made promises, broken promises, or are renewing your promises,
you are beloved and you are welcome here.
Whatever is on your heart, however it is with your soul in this moment, you are beloved and you are welcome here.
We light our chalice this morning in this space of welcome and acceptance, commitment and recommitment, of covenant and connection.
Let us worship together.
Amen. And now, if you would rise in body or spirit for hymn 112, Do You Hear?
Greetings, and welcome to All Souls Church Unitarian. I'm Shari Gilbert, she, her, and I'm your worship associate this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
We gather at All Souls in person or on Zoom, accepting each other and ourselves as we are today, where we greet and embrace all gender identities, sexual orientation, abilities, race, creed, and religion. We gather to celebrate our successes with others or to seek comfort when in pain. We gather to be present with ourselves and others on this day that has been given to us. If you're visiting us for the first time or still feel new here, please raise your hand or put your name in the Zoom chat so that we can give you an All Souls welcome. Are there guests today? Welcome. Our weekly email bulletin is a great way to find out all the latest news. Sign up through the link on the All Souls homepage. Today, we honor the great legacy of Indigenous and enslaved peoples at the International Crossroads we now call Washington, D.C. For generations, the Indigenous Piscataway tribes have been the traditional caretakers of our bioregion. They were trading peoples in the region who lived along the Anacostia and Potomac rivers. Over 200 years ago, Euro-American settler colonists founded this church. We have inhabited three All Souls Church buildings on different sites taken from Indigenous peoples. Each was built by workers that were immigrants or descendants of enslaved and Indigenous peoples. The heritage of all these ancestors is still here in this region and in our congregation. In 2024, our All Souls beloved community is pledging to learn more about these complex histories. May we learn together wherever we reside as we begin with the past and imagine the future. Now I invite you to greet one another. On Zoom, go to gallery view and turn your camera on if willing and able. In the sanctuary, feel free to get up, move around as you are comfortable. Let's take some time to say hello.
Good, here she comes.
I think we need,
yeah.
Let's continue our conversations after the service in Pierce Hall. And again, welcome to All Souls.
That was interesting. I brought the book up, but I had taken the page out, so I need that. Good morning, everyone. I'm Reverend Louise, pronouns she, her. It's good to be with you here this morning. I'd like to begin by giving a big welcome to our guest preacher, the Reverend Ali Casey Bell. Reverend Ellie is our colleague at Cedar Lane Unitarian Universalist Congregation in Bethesda and is a bold and beautiful chaplain in Black Lives UU and a leader in our wider denomination as well. It's so great they're here, and I look forward to the message. Reverend Bill is preaching at First Unitarian Baltimore this morning, so we wave up the highway to him and send greetings to that congregation, wishing them well. Coffee hour is in Pierce Hall this morning. It's out the doors to your right. There's a welcoming corner if you're newish in the house, and you can take a red mug as well to indicate that you're new and would like or invite some conversation. There's a building tour available today. If that's something you haven't done before, it's really fun to get a sense of the whole landscape here. And that is going to be offered by Shari Gilbert. You meet in the Reeb lobby at 12:15, and this is part of the Hope Rises campaign for more people to see the whole building. Welcoming Wednesday happens every Wednesday, and it is 6:30 this Wednesday with a dialogue with Philosophical Souls. And the topic is, what is community? How do we live it? What is it? And then I ask that you check out the order of service, the newsletter, the website. There's a lot of April events, and many of them are right in front of you, either in the online program or in your hand. So take a look at what's there, and you are welcome at all. Turning now to our time of congregational care, I'd like to offer many congratulations to Judith Bauer, who received the Catalyst Award from Dance Exchange in Tacoma Park last night. Yay! Judith is the lead artist for the Dance On Creative Aging program. She is a wonderful force of nature, as we know, and I would like to be her when I grow up, I think. The celebration of life for Tom Fox is coming next Saturday, March 23rd. It's at 10 a.m., a little earlier than we usually do, so noting that. There's a Zoom link on the calendar website, and then a reception will follow in Pierce Hall for those that are here in the building. Now I'd like to invite Carol Falk and Alan Johnson to speak about their view on our capital campaign, Hope Rises.
Good morning. We came to All Souls 42 years ago when our first child was 2 years old, and we wanted the support of a progressive religious community in raising our children. As many of you know, that child was Philip, who as a young adult met his wife, Claire Knoll, at All Souls. With their two kids, we're now a three-generation family active in the church.
From the beginning, we realized that for the church to support us, we needed to support the church with time and treasure. Alan joined the RE committee, and I joined the Canvas committee. We knew that a congregationally governed church had to be mostly self-supporting, and that pledging was important. But we don't spend money lightly. we lived on Alan's salary as a school teacher and saved mine during my working years because we wanted kids and I wanted to be an at-home mom. College and retirement funds were priorities. However, we recognized that All Souls Church also had an important role in our lives. Through my work on the Canvas Committee, we learned what it takes financially to operate a church and what constitutes a generous pledge. We wanted to be among those generous folks, so we upped our pledge.
Now that our kids are grown and we're both long retired, we still have those frugal habits. We don't even own a car. We dip into savings only for travel adventures and charitable contributions. We give all of my required distributions from my IRA directly to charities, All Souls high on that list. And incidentally, that IRA grew into a nice nest egg because we put the maximum allowed into tax-deferred retirement funds during my working years. As a math teacher, I often taught a unit titled How to Get Rich Slowly. It works.
Over the years, we've responded to annual appeals to raise our pledge, and this is the fourth capital campaign we've contributed to. During the pandemic years, we gave extra and increased our pledge significantly because we wanted to support our wonderful staff. At this point, we are well above the tithing category shown on the giving guide for annual pledges. Now, much of that staff is leaving or has already left. We are very sad about that. And frankly, these changes are unsettling when the wider world looks so scary.
However, this is our church. It's not the staff's church, nor even the minister's. We believe in All Souls and what it stands for. We need All Souls and the building that holds our hopes and dreams more than ever. We don't always get it right at All Souls, but at least the church is full of people who are trying to do the right thing and not just thinking of themselves. So for the next 3 years, we're matching our annual pledge with an equally generous donation to the capital campaign.
If you have not, if you have not already pledged, we urge you to join us in making your own generous pledges to the Hope Rises campaign. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carol and Alan. I so appreciate your generous spirits, warm hearts, words to live by. Appreciate you. And as we move into a time of prayer and meditation, I ask you to bring to mind those people or situations that are on your heart today. You can speak the names aloud or into the chat on Zoom. A time for shared prayer. Spirit of life, Holy One of many names, we gather today in many rhythms of life, seeking community, yearning for care. May we be tender with one another. As we bring our deep desires for sustenance and change, may we hold this time together as ground and inspiration. We give thanks for this hour to be the church. Amen.
Those things spoken and unspoken, we say amen. The only time I lived in a small town was when I was in graduate school at Northern Illinois University in DeKalb, Illinois. Between the townies, population of 36,000, and the 20,000 gownies, it wasn't that small, but still, the smallest place I ever lived. There wasn't a lot of traffic, and I rode my bike most of the time anyway, but there were enormous and powerful freight trains that ran right through downtown about every 30 minutes, and I am not exaggerating. Getting stuck behind one of those long trains was always a good excuse for being late to class. I loved that Midwestern town. Its main street and beautiful 19th century buildings. The town was surrounded by cornfields, and a flat landscape and a huge open sky is still my favorite outdoor vista. Since graduating, I've given annually to my alumni association. My annual gift to them is less than my monthly gift to All Souls, but I know that every dollar counts. I attend Alumni Association happy hours when they're here in DC and love reminiscing about the university and my years in DeKalb. When the liberal arts and science dean and the advancement person were in town last fall, they asked to meet with me about my planning giving ideas. I don't have any. I agreed to meet, but was nervous that they'd be pushy and that I'd be embarrassed about my paltry giving amount. But they were gracious and appreciative of my 30-year history of giving. This week, I met with a visiting steward for the All Souls Hope Rises capital campaign. I am so impressed with the generous pledges already made by early and major donors like Carolyn Allen. And even though I know this isn't really the UU way, I was nervous about meeting my visiting steward because I was afraid that she'd be pushy and that I'd be embarrassed that I'm making a minor rather than a major pledge. But like my experience with the grad school development folks, she was similarly gracious and appreciative of my 10-year giving history with All Souls and gentle and encouraging about my capital campaign pledge. And as I said before, we all know, every dollar counts. This week, all non-pledged donations will be split with our Share the Plate organization of the month. Harriet's Wildest Dreams, named to honor Harriet Tubman. Harriet's Wildest Dreams is a Black-led abolitionist community defense hub centering all Black lives, most at risk for state-sanctioned violence to the greater Washington area. Their work includes legal empowerment, political and civic education, mass protest, organizing campaigns, and community care that builds alternatives to oppressive systems. If you're in the sanctuary, the ushers will be passing the plate for our offering. You can also text to All Souls by sending ASCU to 73256. If you're on Zoom, click the link in the chat, which will direct you to All Souls Online Giving. Thank you for your generosity.
Would I harbor you?
The concern I lay bare before God today is my need for courage. I need courage to be honest. Honest in my use of words, honest in accepting responsibility, honest in dealing with myself, honest in dealing with my fellows, honest in my relations with God. I need courage to face the problems of my own life, the problems of personal values. They are confused and they are often unreal. They are too exacting for comfort. The problems of my job. Perhaps I am working at cross purposes with my own desires, ambitions, equipment. Perhaps I am arrogant instead of taking pride in doing work well. Perhaps I am doing what I am doing just to prove a point, spending a lifetime to prove a point that is not worth providing after all. Perhaps have never found anything that could challenge me, and my life seems wasted. Here in the quietness, I lay bare honest for the guidance to deal effectually with the problems of my own life. Oh God, thou will not despise.
You can be amazing, instead of raising to a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast, to be the backlash, somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up.
Bye.
you, choir. That was just amazing. So great. Ah, you all did an amazing job. Two nights ago, I held a virtual caring circle at my congregation, Cedar Lane UU, for Next Benedict, a two-spirit, transgender, nonconforming, 16-year-old child of Choctaw descent, and Ryan Gaynor, a 15-year-old Black autistic boy. As the autopsy report came out of Oklahoma about Nex's death, which the medical examiner stated was suicide, and the news about Ryan's death, a fatal police shooting, I found myself, a Black trans autistic man, who is the parent of gender expansive and neurodiverse children, sitting at the intersection of the ways in which people like me are threatened every day for just living, breathing, being. I found myself holding the despair, rage, and fear that comes when one's very existence is threatened by characteristics about themselves that they cannot change. I reminded myself that this is the inevitability of being in a country founded on genocide and subjugation and colonization. Every system poisoned by the circumstances of our founding, and every person and each generation since its inception, gravely harmed by it. It used to be that I would have called colonization our country's original sin. However, I've started to really turn over what that meant, considering that not everyone subscribes to the theology, and if they do, they understand that it means that the people who came after Adam and Eve were not responsible and could do nothing to free themselves from the original sin, except to wait for God to intervene. I don't think that's a practical way to challenge a system that is literally killing. Literally killing everything it touches, our environment, our public systems, our livelihood, our children. I believe the only choice we have is to embrace all of the emotions that we are feeling, to settle our minds to the cause of liberation, and to continue to work towards that end. That's why Sarah Bareilles' Brave, the song the choir sang, reminds me that I can and will be brave, even when I am feeling tired and scared and angry and hurt. The juxtaposition of this song against the deaths of these teenagers isn't lost on me. They were both brave. They were struggling in a system designed to force them to comply, conform, or be broken. Audre Lorde knew of these decisions hoisted upon those of us at the margins. She wrote in her poem, A Litany for Survival, "For those of us who live at the shoreline, standing upon the constant edges of decision, crucial and alone. For those of us who cannot indulge the passing dreams of choice, who love in the doorways, coming and going in the hours between dawns, looking inward and outward at once before and after, seeking a now that can breed futures like bread in our children's mouths, so their dreams will not reflect the death of ours. For those of us who were imprinted with fear like a faint line in the center of our foreheads, learning to be afraid with our mother's milk. For by this weapon, this illusion of some safety to be found, the heavy-footed hope to silence us, for all of us, this instant and this triumph, we were never meant to survive. Nex and Ryan and me and my children and my partner and many of you, we were never meant to survive. Nex and Ryan are gone. We are still here. And we intend on continuing to not only survive, but to thrive. That thriving starts with allowing ourselves to see fear for what it is. In my early teen years, I learned an acronym from fear. Maybe some of you have heard it, the F word, everything and run, F-E-A-R, F everything and run. It made sense to me. There was no reason to stick around if I was afraid of something or someone. But to give credit where it is due, that acronym also was in a book called Bag of Bones by Stephen King. Right before I went to college, my mom reminded me that fear was to be overcome, like in the book Dune. She recited the litany against fear to me one last time before I crossed the threshold into my burgeoning adult life. I found myself whispering it in situations where I knew of no other way to get through. I must not fear. Fear is the mind killer. Fear is the little death that brings total obliteration. I will face my fear. I will permit it to pass over me and through me. And when it has gone past, I will turn the inner eye to see its path. Where the fear has gone, there will be nothing. Only I will remain. However, to actually get through, I needed to learn about fear. Fear is an emotional and biological response to a perceived danger. It starts in a tiny part of our brain called the amygdala, and it activates our psychobiological defense systems: flight, fight, fawn, freeze, flop, depending on what that danger is. Our amygdala prepares our whole body, while our frontal cortex and our hippocampus sort out the threat level. In the Smithsonian Magazine, an article entitled "What Happens in the Brain When We Feel Fear and Why Some of Us Just Can't Get Enough of It," the author states, "Seeing a lion in the wild can trigger a strong fear reaction, but the response to a view of the same lion at a zoo is more of curiosity and thinking that the lion is cute." This is because the hippocampus and the frontal cortex process contextual information, and inhibitory pathways dampen the amygdala fear response and its downstream results. Basically, our thinking circuitry of the brain reassures our emotional areas that we are, in fact, okay, says the Smithsonian. Similar to other animals, we very often learn fear through personal experiences, such as being attacked by an aggressive dog or observing other humans being attacked by an aggressive dog. However, an evolutionarily unique and fascinating way of learning in humans is through instruction. We learn from the spoken words or written notes. If a sign says the dog is dangerous, proximity to the dog will trigger a fear response. Let that sink in, and the signs that we use all over our world. So, what do we do to get past those defense systems, to become the co-conspirators for liberation that we want to be? How do we stop fight, flight, fawn, freeze, flop from keeping us quiet, small, and disconnected? First, we have to feel. We can't just bypass what we are feeling. Admitting to our feelings of vulnerability, being aware of our tender space, and being willing to allow ourselves to feel big things is just as important in our deconstruction of systems of oppression as is in learning how to be anti-racist. I would argue it may be even more important, because if we cannot connect empathetically and honestly with ourselves, how can we expect to be able to connect with others? Next is E. Engage the issue. Whatever it is, we must allow ourselves to connect to others. To engage is to hope. To hope is to answer back to those systems that there is a better way. Having hope, keeping hope, and rebuilding the courage to hope are all concepts that require us to practice an active hope. Throughout the book, Act of Hope, How to Face the Mess We're In Without Going Crazy, Macy and Johnston draw on insights from various fields, including psychology, ecology, and spirituality, to offer practical exercises and strategies for cultivating active hope in everyday life. They emphasize the importance of community, connection, and collective action in building resilience and creating positive change. When we can imagine hope as multifaceted as anything we've ever seen, a multifaceted phenomenon, that supplies us an opportunity to engage from many angles. Then we take hope and allow it to A, activate our response. This is where it often feels like we're doing something about things, but don't get caught up in that. Through each of these steps, we are doing the work of building towards liberation. Often in this stage, we get caught up in how we want to help and who we want to help instead of taking a moment to engage in their inner workings of the community. We also need to be aware of individualism that often overshadows liberal movements and liberal faith. To be active agents of change is our deep and urgent need to turn away from individualism that is baked into our theological roots as UUs. Adrienne Marie Brown, author and activist, speaks to the concept of rugged individualism with a more nuanced understanding when she states, most of us are socialized towards independence, pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps, working on our own to develop, to survive, to win at life. Competition is the way we hone our skill and comfort with the opposite of mutual reliance. We learn to feel proud about how much we achieve as individuals, and sometimes to actively work to bring others down in order to get ahead. In a capitalist society like the United States, every aspect of our survival, from food and water to healthcare, childcare, and elder care, is based on our success at being an individual in the world. We could reason our way to a more sustainable process, but we use our intelligence to outsmart each other. She states that interdependence is iterative, meaning we must practice it again and again. Being interdependent is a series of small, repetitive actions. Which brings us to the source of our Unitarian Universalist Association's individualism, in my opinion, Emerson. In his 2012 Berry Street essay, From I Church to Beloved Community, Ecclesiology and Justice, Reverend Frederick Muir wrote of Emerson. He stated, I have read enough of Emerson to feel certain that he celebrated the gifts of individuality, the beauty of nature's difference and diversity, of which humans are a part. We, as a nation and as a religious community, took the blessing and joy of individuality and made it into an ideology, made it a polity, and made it a theology. We did a very bad job, actually, of making it a polity. We went from individuality to individualism to the demise of institutional religion. While individualism may have been a bold and appealing way to create and build a nation and its institutions and to grow Unitarian Universalism, it might even have felt natural or God-given. It is not sustaining. Individualism will not serve the greater good, a principle to which we have committed ourselves. There is little to nothing about the ideology and theology of individualism, he states, that encourages people to work and live together, to create and support institutions that serve common aspirations and beloved principles. This was a way of dreaming and living before the storm. And friends, if you have been exposed to all that I've been exposed to in our news cycles, you know that the storm that we are in right now is catastrophic. In a catastrophic storm, all of us need all of us to survive. There is no time for individualism. There is only time for weaving a stronger web to catch those who are falling and for drawing a circle wider, so wide that there is no margin. Reverend Murr goes on to state, we have been telling two stories of which only one will deepen and grow our future. One of those stories, the one in which we lead, is from the transcendentalist and is captured and articulated in the shadow side of our principles. When used as an expression of individualism rather than an expression of the joy and celebration of individuality, the principles become dangerously close to sounding like an ideology or creed turned theology or spirituality. I agree with Reverend Murr. We have. The thing about it is that in the last, I would say, 6 or 7 years as a faith, we've been moving towards remedying these missteps. This is why we're seeing programs that ask us to question what we do and why we do them, that ask us to question who benefits from the status quo, that ask us to question how we are actually living into the values that we espouse, and currently in the process of revising Article 2 of our bylaws, where our principles reside. First, we have started with this statement of covenant. This is the proposal. As Unitarian Universalists, we covenant congregation to congregation and through our association to support and assist one another in our ministries. That sounds pretty good. We draw from our heritages of freedom, reason, hope, courage, building on the foundation of love. Love is the power that holds us together and is the center of our shared values. We are accountable to one another for doing the work of living our shared values through the spiritual discipline of love, inseparable from one another. These shared values are, and then it is proposed that we start with interdependence. We honor the interdependent web of all existence. We covenant to cherish earth and all beings by creating and nurturing relationships of care and respect. With humility and reverence, we acknowledge our place in the great web of life, and we work to repair harm and damaged relationships. We are now proposing to start with interdependence and to move away from the individualism of the I. They continue from there, incorporating the principles that we so deeply cherish and pointing toward a new way forward for us to live into interdependence. Living interdependently is how we are rise, because we need one another to do this holy work of change. We need one another. We need each other just as every caretaker and everyone being cared for needs one another. We need one another just as each member of our choir needs one another. We need one another just as each of us needed one another today to bring about this space of worship, this space of solace, this space of courage. We need one another because there is no way that any of us survive this broken system without each other. So now turn to your neighbor and tell them, we need one another. We need one another. We need one another. And now I would like you to turn inside to yourself and make a commitment that when fear comes knocking, which it will, you will feel, engage, activate, and rise. Amen, ashe, and blessed be.
Reverend Ali said to connect to the rise. When we feel the fear, feel how we can rise together. Our closing song, which is The Fire of Commitment, talks about a faith set free from fear. That's our faith, Unitarian Universalism. In that spirit, I invite you to take a deep breath, to rise in body, rise in spirit for the fire of commitment.
Go courageously forth, knowing that fear will come. Let your light burn from this moment on and take effective steps within your own powers to live up to the light and to build the kind of world we so deeply desire. May it be so.
It's been